Good day, I'm Norman Wabiger. In today's video, we're going to look at an interesting range of topics, a little bit wider and more general than we usually do. I'm going to try to slowly start to reorient you with respect to what the nature of geometrical questions is, given that we're trying to let go of this dream of real numbers. So it has a lot of consequences in terms of rethinking the role of geometry and algebra, not just analysis. We'll be talking about that today. So I'm going to mention this issue of the continuum, very important and contentious idea that has intrigued millennia of mathematicians and scientists, and indeed philosophers and religious people too. Is naturally associated to the question of what is space? What kind of world are we living in? What is time? This illusion of time passing on relatively continuously, is it true? What is it actually about? One nice starting point for the discussion might be to think about the different scales that we can look at when we're talking about the continuum. Well, we have something like this. This represents a continuum. We could look at it up close, or we could try to look at it from far away and get a much bigger sense of scale. For that, there's a lovely YouTube video of a movie made in 1977 called Powers of 10. And I strongly recommend that you have a look at this. It's a nice orientation to the huge differences in scales in our visible universe. Of course, this is already quite some time ago, and so our understanding of the world has, of course, moved on considerably since then, but nevertheless, it's still a very valuable and interesting thing to look at. All right, so here's an example of a continuum. We get a ruler, we move our pen along the ruler, we create this nice line which appears to be very smooth, uniform, and divisible. Okay, there's not anything particularly different about a small section of it than a larger section, it appears. But upon closer inspection, if we actually get a microscope and look at some little part of it, then we see that the uniformity and the smoothness are a little bit illusory. It looks more lumpy, grainy. One might see fibrous strings or tissues there if we magnify that with a microscope. And then if we go further and magnify further, say with a electron microscope, then we could see molecules, and ultimately atoms are somewhere in there, composed of electrons, protons, neutrons, eventually quarks, and perhaps other things called strings or other things that we don't know about. So there's a range of things that's happening here. It's clear that physically the continuum is much more complicated and grainy than we like to think. So there's a natural kind of tension between the mathematics, which is trying to get at the continuum as a smooth kind of object, continuous, and the physical reality that suggests that things are actually quite complicated once we start looking at things up close. So this is a very important mathematical question. It's a fundamental and basic question in mathematics, how to model the continuum, how to bring our intuitive idea of continuity into precise mathematical framework. In fact, it's such an important problem that I've addressed it in my famous math problems series. And so famous math problem 19, which is actually four videos, talks all about the importance and history a little bit of this very important question, which in my mind is probably the single most fundamental and important question in all of mathematics. So it's a problem that has engaged mathematicians since the ancient Greeks, and many people since then have pondered this in one form or another. Even in the days of the ancient Greeks, it was realized that there were some seemingly contradictory or at least problematic aspects with our intuitive understanding of the continuum. Some of these were put into quite a clear context by a mathematician called Zeno, who came up with a paradox, or in fact several paradoxes, to illustrate that sometimes things can be a little bit confusing when we think about the continuum, and especially motion or movement in a continuous fashion. So one of Zeno's paradoxes, often called Achilles and the Tortoise, features Achilles and Tortoise. And they are having a race, both going in this direction here. And the Tortoise is in front and goes rather slowly and steadily. And Achilles is behind, but he's a fast runner. So we would, of course, imagine that in a position like this, if we looked at it some short time afterwards, the Tortoise would have moved up a little bit, but Achilles would have gone past the Tortoise and would be way out in front of it. But Zeno says, well, consider the following argument. If we're watching two of them move together, eventually Achilles is going to get to the place where the Tortoise is now. Okay, so when Achilles gets to exactly this position, well, the Tortoise will have moved ahead a little bit. Okay, so the Tortoise is still in front. And then at some later point, Achilles gets to that position where the Tortoise was secondarily, but then the Tortoise has also moved a little bit ahead. And so we get this infinite progression of Achilles catching up to where the Tortoise was a split second ago, but the Tortoise having moved a little bit further. And so it appears that Achilles can actually never reach the Tortoise and never pass him. Of course, we know that this argument isn't entirely sound, but exactly pinning down what's wrong with it turns out to be quite an interesting and tricky business. Here's another variant of Zeno's argument. Suppose that we have an interval, and it's labeled 0 to 1. And here's the point a half, and here's the point a quarter, and here's 1/8, and here's 1/16, and so on. Right, so suppose we want to walk from 1 to 0. Okay, we want to walk from 1 to 0. Well, we certainly need to pass the point marked a half, and we need to pass the point marked 1/4, and the point marked 1/8, and the point marked 1/16, and so on. But we can't do an infinite number of things, because each one of these things is something that we're doing. We can't do an infinite number of things, so clearly we can never reach zero. So it's interesting that even 2 millennia ago, the impossibility of doing an infinite number of tasks was acknowledged by the ancient Greeks. It was pretty clear to them that you couldn't do an infinite number of things. And that's the origins of the conundrum here. So how do we deal with this conundrum? Is it really a mathematical conundrum, or is it a physical conundrum, or is it a philosophical conundrum? Well, I think every mathematics student should ponder this. It's not entirely so easy to resolve this, and there's different ways of thinking about it, or seeing how to restate it, or seeing how to look at it in such a way that perhaps the dilemma goes away. But I think it's a good thing for everyone to do. So we're going to leave this out there, something for you to think about and maybe discuss. And eventually we might want to come back and have another think about what's really going on here. In any case, we see that issues about continuity and motion were already problematic and interesting even 2,000 years ago. A key problem is that the nature of the physical continuum, that is, the actual idea of a continuum in the physical world, is still a deep mystery. In fact, if anything, it's become more and more mysterious as time has gone on, and the 20th century has certainly seen an explosion in the conceptual difficulties associated with understanding the continuum. As we've probed to smaller and smaller lengths, we see that the world becomes ever increasingly different from the one that we're used to, more challenging to understand, mathematically quite different. So there's at least two reasons immediately that we can put up to explain this. One of them is that probing smaller and smaller objects requires more and more energy. It's a fundamental aspect of the physics, that if you have a photon, which is a little particle of light, it always zips along at the speed of light, but it has a kind of frequency, and the frequency can be less or more. So it's a fundamental fact of physics that if the frequency is less, then the energy of the photon is less. And if the frequency is more, then the energy is more. And you can perhaps see that if you want to explore or look at something that's very small, you're probably going to need a photon with this kind of frequency rather than this one. So you want the wavelength here to be small compared to the actual thing that you're looking at so that you get some resolution. But the effect of that is that if you want to look at something very, very small, you actually need a quite high energy beam of light to look at it. Okay, and this is maybe a little bit counterintuitive because you might think that smaller and smaller things should require less energy because, you know, they're pretty small, you don't have to shine too much light. But in fact, you have to shine a lot of light, or at least a lot of high energy light or radiation of some kind on it to reveal the structure. A second reason is that at very small scales, quantum mechanical effects kick in. All right, so quantum mechanics is this very mysterious replacement of classical mechanics that really only starts being valid and observable at very small scales. And it's very different and relatively weird if you're used to classical physics. And the reality is that this certainly makes discussion of small things complicated. In particular, there's something called the uncertainty principle, which is closely related to this discussion up here, that says that you can't find the position of a particle and it's also its momentum or velocity sort of simultaneously at the same time up to small precision. So the more precision you have in position, the less precision you have in velocity and vice versa. So there's some kind of bound on how precisely we are able to understand. So almost as if nature has built in an obstacle that prevents us from understanding things too well at a small scale. Interestingly, there are also serious challenges with the mathematical continuum, assuming such a thing exists. So one reason for that is that probing smaller and smaller objects requires more and more energy, well, and time and memory. So a very parallel reason to what was happening in the physical situation. The reason is that when we are looking at smaller and smaller things, we require fractions, okay? And the fractions are getting smaller. And what happens when you look at fractions which are getting smaller? Well, at some point they look like this. This is in the early stages when you just start. You get fractions which have numerators and denominators which are still relatively small. 1/2, 1/4, 3/7, minus 21/5. It doesn't take a lot of energy or time or memory resources to write down such fractions. However, if you start to subdivide and look further and further into some smaller region, necessarily you're going to end up working with fractions which are getting more complicated. The numerators and the denominators are getting bigger. Even if the fractions themselves are getting a lot smaller, this fraction is much smaller than any of these. But it's much more complicated. It takes more energy to deal with. So it's interesting that there's a parallel between the physical story of trying to use photons of increasingly high frequency to pick up the resolution of things and having to work with fractions of increasingly big denominators and numerators to mathematically access smaller and smaller intervals or objects. There's a second reason as well, that computational effects having to do with round off or floating point errors or overflow kick in at small or very large scales. So it's a kind of mathematical uncertainty. In practice, when we're measuring things, we usually use floating point, so there's a certain amount of imprecision. And the smaller we get, the worse at capturing what's going on we are with this kind of framework. We naturally end up having more and more error and less accuracy. Okay, so these things are obviously related, but there's some kind of parallel to what's going on in the physical world. Now let's venture towards the biological side of this story. So we're human beings. We're creatures with a certain evolutionary history, a certain very specific biology, a certain brain makeup, certain number of senses. And these things really affect very strongly our perception of the world around us, and also the kind of mental constructs that we're likely to make in terms of understanding that world. For example, we would imagine that if we were, say, dolphins swimming around, similarly intelligent, trying to figure out the world, we would have different inclinations about modeling things because our sense inputs would be so very different. So I want to talk a little bit about how the biology and our physical orientation sort of orients us towards certain beliefs about the physical world and corresponding aspects that the geometrical world should have as well. So it's very useful to have some appreciation and explicit awareness of what these issues are, or at least some of them. All right, so our physical and practical intuitions can get in our way. So here are some of the things that makes us what we are, part of the reason why we're so effective and why our understanding has gone so far, but also perhaps explaining some of the limits and boundaries and challenges that we might face. So first of all, we are highly visual creatures. Our eyes are fabulous things, and we have a large part of our brain that's oriented towards understanding the visual information we're getting from our eyes. We are programmed to think dynamically. We live in a world of movement, and we think about cause and effect, about time going on and things moving around. So it's very natural for us to try to frame our mathematics in terms of something moving or something dynamic. It's what we are. We tend to equate big with important and small with insignificant. In our world, if something is big, it's probably an important aspect of our world. And if it's something that's small, well, we can generally ignore it. So, for example, if we look at these two numbers, n, which is 4,513,800, and epsilon, which is 1 over 4,513,800, our natural inclination is to treat these numbers very differently. This is a big number. It represents something significant. This is a very small number. We're wondering why there's so much fuss about the detail here. It's so small, who cares really what these things are? In our naive point of view, this is a much more important number than this one. And in practice, that's quite reasonable. But from a pure mathematical point of view, it's not so simple. There's in fact a very profound symmetry between very big things and very small things, having to do with a simple interchange that we can go from x to 1 over x. If that's x and it's very big, then 1 over x is very small. If this is x and it's very small, then 1 over x is very big. So any confusions about very small things can be translated via this basic symmetry into a confusion about very large things and vice versa. So we have to be aware that our orientation may be leading us a little bit astray when it comes to very small things. In fact, this has a very significant effect on the way people think about real numbers. Because engineers, for example, who say work to decimal places, to 10 significant figures and no further, we'll look at this discussion about real numbers that we're having as basically an inconsequential one. Because the difference between a real number with decimals that go on forever and a decimal that an engineer uses, namely say to 10 decimal places, is to them insignificant. The difference between all those trillions and trillions and, well, infinitely many digits that we're dropping is completely insignificant. So there's a psychological aspect about not thinking that the nature of real numbers is perhaps very important. It doesn't matter if we're cheating when it comes to real numbers, because it's all so very small, tail end of decimals kind of thing. In fact, of course, the issue is quite different, right? It's really actually fundamentally important, theoretically, to get the foundations of the continuum right. So it's very, very important. But this is, I think, a profound way in which our physical biology somehow interferes sometimes with our approach to certain mathematical things. But there are many other aspects of this story. Another interesting aspect of our biology is that we are very good at identifying straight lines and circles. You can all see this is a straight line. You can all see that this is a circle. If I had changed this straight line, for example, if I had drawn it by hand instead of with a ruler, you'd all be able to see that this is probably not exactly a straight line, that it looks like it's been drawn freehand. And certainly if I drew a circle freehand, even if I tried to do it very accurately, you'd be able to tell that this was a freehand circle, not one that I've used an instrument to draw. Okay. Maybe this explains why the ancient Greeks were so enamored of circles and lines, that perhaps biologically we're somehow programmed to respond and understand and appreciate these two fundamental figures. Another thing that we're good at is identifying translated, rotated, and reflected objects. If we take some object and we move it around, that's actually quite a complicated thing for the brain to register, but we do this so automatically, we can instantly see that this pointer is the same as this pointer. Right? I can put it in different places. You still clearly can identify it's the same object. Here's an object. I've translated it to here. You can see that these two are the same. Here to here, well, I've translated, but I've also rotated. You can see that this is a rotation of this one. Maybe not so entirely clear, but if you look at it for a little while, perhaps you can convince yourself that this one's a reflection of this one. That's a little bit harder to do, but we also have a pretty good sense of reflections. We're very good at identifying scaled objects. If we scale something up, it's easy for us to identify that it's really the same kind of thing. Right? This and this, pretty well the same. This is just a little bit bigger. So this leads us, these talents lead us to sort of assuming that space is homogeneous. You know, this part of space and this part of the space have essentially the same properties. That it's isotropic. If I'm looking in this direction or I'm looking in this direction, it's the same. There's nothing special about this direction that I'm not going to have in this direction as well. Okay? Moving things around doesn't change anything dramatically. But space is scale invariant. Okay, that's maybe more debatable because biological things have a certain natural size and, you know, it's hard to imagine a mosquito being the size of an elephant or something. But still, there's a sort of intuition we have that space itself somehow the same at different scales. Whether these, in fact, are correct or not is a different story, okay? But what I'm saying is that our biology naturally inclines us to thinking this way. It may be that these things are, in fact, fundamentally not true at all. But nevertheless, that's certainly the way we're oriented. But there's a few more things, too, that are also quite important. Something else that we're very good at is identifying order relations. Here are three points on a line, A, B, and C. We can immediately tell that B is between A and C. Here are four points in the plane, E, F, D, and G. We can pretty easily tell, just visually, that G is inside the triangle DEF. That would be very easy if I actually drew the triangle, but even without the triangle, I think we can see just visually that the point G is going to be inside that triangle. So our capacity of making visual judgments and essentially calculations is really quite astonishing. Another thing that we're quite familiar with intuitively is the relationship between the three-dimensional space that we live in and a two-dimensional slice of it. So it's obvious to us that space is sort of isotropic. It doesn't matter what direction we choose a plane, that all these planes are basically the same. If I take that particular plane in three-dimensional space, its geometrical properties are going to be exactly the same as this plane's properties. Now, that's a physical feeling that we have, And it's a kind of a dimension compatibility, that the two-dimensional geometry of the plane is sitting inside the three-dimensional geometry of space. All right, so having laid out some of the orientations that we naturally have due to our biology, let's have a look at how this affects our understanding of the very big changes in going from Euclidean geometry to the 17th century Cartesian geometry of Descartes, one of the most important developments in the history of mathematics, introducing algebra, whereas before there really only was geometry, or at least mostly geometry. So to Euclid, the framework is an empty page, a piece of paper, on which we can construct points and lines, perhaps circles, and perhaps more complicated other objects like conics. To Descartes, eventually we have a Cartesian coordinate system, x and y, with axes labeled, which allows us to think of points as being represented by ordered pairs of numbers. So the coordinates here are telling us where this point is. And in fact, it's giving us an idea of what a point is, and more precise than what Euclid had. Euclid struggled to define what a point is, what a line is, what a circle is. In the Cartesian framework, we can use the arithmetic of these coordinates that we have to define what a point is. It's an ordered pair of numbers. To define what a line is, it's an equation of the form x plus 2y equals 2, linear in x and y. We can define what a circle is. It's an equation of the form x minus 1 squared plus y minus 2 squared equals 1. And so on, we can deal with more elaborate curves and equations. So very powerful method to pin down what we're talking about, and very importantly, to define what it is that we're talking about. So Cartesian coordinates let us define points, lines, circles, perpendicularity, and many other things much more precisely than in Euclidean geometry. So a huge advance, a huge development, with many positive aspects, really laying the foundation for 20th century linear algebra. But, okay, there is a but. There is another side to this story which is rarely discussed. And it's actually quite important for us to understand the other side of this story. Going from here to here, something also has been lost. Or let's say something is made more complicated or more subtle or maybe more problematic. It's important for us to appreciate what has happened. Okay? We pay a price for the coordinates that we introduce. So why is that? Well, awkwardly, the geometry created from the Cartesian approach does not automatically obey all our Euclidean or physical assumptions. We are building something, but what we are building is sometimes at odds with our intuition, the kinds of intuitions and physical understandings that we talked about earlier. For example, when you have a coordinate system, there is an origin. There is a special point that you've designated. So you've added something to the structure which is not intrinsically there. The coordinate axes themselves become something that you impose on the situation. There are then these two preferred directions. There's a notion of horizontal, a notion of vertical. And that introduces into this geometry that used to be rotationally invariant. It introduces a certain orientation. And it then becomes no longer obvious that if we rotate something, that its essential nature hasn't changed. It's no longer obvious that if we translate something, its essential nature hasn't changed. And when we go to three dimensions by introducing an algebraic framework involving triples of numbers for points, it's then no longer obvious that the equation of a plane in this three-dimensional space algebraically has the same kind of properties as the two-dimensional plane from the xy axes. Another way of saying this is that number theoretical considerations are an inevitable consequence of adapting an arithmetical approach to geometry. That's what we're doing, where we're putting arithmetic before geometry. We're saying, let's suppose we have an arithmetical system, some kind of field, like the rational numbers, or if you're a wishful dreamer, like the real numbers. Then we use that field, that number system, to create the geometrical objects, to create points via ordered pairs, to create lines via equations, linear, to create circles via quadratic equations, and so on, with the coefficients taken from the field that we're working with. So the geometry becomes subservient to the arithmetic. And therefore, number theoretical aspects of the arithmetic in this field we're working with necessarily become completely intertwined with geometrical considerations. This is a complication that you don't see very clearly when you have a naive Euclidean point of view, where you just have an empty page on which we're making constructions. So, some examples. Intersections of curves, the isotropy of space, this dimension compatibility that we talked about, order relations, all of these and other things as well become much more subtle once we embrace the arithmetical nature of geometry. And this really goes a long ways also to explain why real numbers are so attractive to modern mathematicians. Because they purport to bridge this gap between the original Euclidean intuitive physical geometry and the actual arithmetical geometry imposed upon us by the Cartesian coordinate system of Descartes. So the real number system, for example, tells us that if we have two curves which look like they intersect, then they do intersect. If we have a circle and we have a line which appears to intersect the circle, for example, then yes, there really are two points of intersection. However, when we let go of the real number dream, then these statements are no longer so obvious. In fact, they are not necessarily true anymore. Whether or not two curves intersect one another is not just a physical or intuitive visual thing that you can easily see. It's rather something that you can determine by a number theoretical analysis of the relevant equations. So more work is required, more subtlety appears, the story becomes richer. The connections with arithmetic, algebra, and geometry become much more manifold. So it's another consequence, but it's a price that we pay from leaving the real numbers behind. And it's ultimately something of a price that we have to pay for introducing these Cartesian coordinates, which are otherwise a very useful and very powerful tool. All right, so I hope this lecture has expanded your thinking a little bit in some directions, got you oriented perhaps in slightly different directions. We're going to be talking more about this kind of aspect further on in this series. In my next video, I want to do something a little bit different. I'm going to actually read you a paper of mine called Real Fish, Real Numbers, Real Jobs, which is semi-humorous, but has a serious intent, and its aim is to convince people to think about the dubious logical aspects of real numbers. So I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wahlberger. Thanks for listening.